Welcome back. In this video, I will discuss about microbial pathogenicity. The word pathogenicity is derived from the Greek word pathos means suffering or disease and genesis means creation. Pathogenicity is the ability of a microbes to cause disease. Any organism that produces such a disease is called a pathogen. It can be a bacteria or it can be a virus or it can be a fungus, parasites or protozoa. A larger organism that supports the survival and growth of a pathogen is called the host. When a pathogen is growing and multiplying within or on a host, physiological conditions of the host are altered. This phenomenon is called an infection, and the host is infected by the pathogen. Disease occurred when the cells or organ in our body are damaged, and because of that, sign and symptoms of illness appeared. Now, what is the difference between sign and symptoms? If the conditions can be examined externally, like cough, running nose, fever, rash, pus, etc., are called sign. And symptoms are the conditions that can only feel by the patient, like pain, nausea, shortness of breathing, etc. Although genetic, biochemical, physiological, hormonal, and life cycle diseases are there, but here I will focus on to microbial diseases only. The main objective of the bacteria is to acquire nutrition and shelter for multiplication, not to kill the host. Different parts of our body exhibit different environmental conditions in terms of pH, temperature, nutrition, moisture, and oxygen availability. And our body itself provides an endless variety of microenvironments and niches. Just because of this, our body is actually a suitable habitat for different microbes. You will be surprised to know that in our body, for each and every single cell, 10 microbes are there. Each and every day, our body comes in contact with limitless number of microbes, but majority of them are either removed or destroyed before they colonize and start dividing. Our own defense mechanisms are always active and engaged to clear those foreign pathogens. Because I don't want to share my foods with anyone. Some daredevil microbes are clever enough. They evolve themselves in such a way so that they can easily escape our attention. Some of them are always ready to start fighting with us, while some of them will gain access to our body only when our immune system is weak. So the relationship between host and pathogen is complex and dynamic. Sometimes host able to survive and sometimes pathogen. It totally depends on who evolve more rapidly. Fortunately, most of the microbes can able to synthesize their own foods and never infect others. They are called non-pathogenic. Some microbes that can able to cause disease in a healthy individual are called primary pathogen or more simply a true pathogen. In contrast, are microbes able to cause disease only when the immune or adaptive immune system are compromised. Or if introduced into an unusual location, they are called an opportunistic pathogen or opportunist. Pathogenic bacteria possesses a special weapon called virulence factor or virulence determinant that actually promote pathogenicity. It can be a part of a bacterial cell or a metabolic product. Another term called virulence, it refers to the degree of pathogenicity of an organism. Or we can say how modern the weapon are. In this video, I will discuss about the virulence factor and its role in pathogenicity. But before that, let's check the common strategies they are adopting for attacking us, that is, the stages of disease progression. The first stage is called the transmissibility or transmission from one host to another. Next step is breaching or invasion of the host. After invasion, they start growing inside our body called colonization. Then they defeated our host immune response called infectivity, and in the last stage the disease or damage occurred and sign and symptoms appeared. Now let's check each and every step in details and microbial virulence associated with it. Like the Great Wall of China, our body is fully covered with skin, although some loopholes are there like eye, mouth, ear, nose, etc. Microbes love to enter inside the body via those routes. Not all pathogenic bacteria follow the same route of transmission from disease host to healthy host. The route of transfer depends on the nature of the microbes and the site of infection. Just like Navy, Air Force and Ground Force, Some microbes like corynebacteria, bordetella can survive in the environment for a longer duration. They introduce into the air via cough and sneeze. The tiny water droplets released during cough contain microbes. It is gradually evaporated and remains suspended in the air, called aerosol. If any healthy individual inhale them, infection initiated and microbes will gain access to nasopharynx and lungs. Some microbes like Vibrio salmonella can enter inside a healthy host via contaminated food and water and will gain access to the gut, whereas Neisseria gonorrhoeae or Mycobacterium leprae cannot survive outside the human host for a longer duration and must be spread by direct contact. Some bacteria takes help from blood-sucking insect to enter into the bloodstream directly, such as Yersinia pestis carried by the rat flea. Finally, virtually any bacteria may enter the host through wounds and burns or any damage onto the skin. Some bacteria lose their patience and try to enter through the hair follicles. But most of the time, successful entry not always leads to disease. Several other microbial factors are also responsible for disease progression, like infectious dose 50 or ID50. Virulence is the measure of pathogenicity of an organism. It can be measured experimentally by determining the number of bacteria required to cause animal death, illness, or lesion in a particular time after the entry by a designated route. The number of bacteria required to attack 50% of a population is called lethal dose 50 or LD50. An effective dose causing a disease symptoms in 50% of a population of animal is called ED50. Both parameters are useful in comparing the relative virulence of different bacteria. You can see that in case of brucellosis, only 10 to 100 bacteria are more than enough to initiate infection. But in case of Vibrio, you have to ingest these number of cells. So if ED50 is less, the bacteria is more pathogenic. That means they are brave soldiers with modern weapons. The route by which bacteria gain access to our body is called portal of entry. For example, if Staphylococcus is inhaled, it causes pneumonia. But if you ingest, it is no longer able to cause disease. On the other hand, some microbes can able to initiate infection in multiple locations, like anthrax. It can initiate infection in lung, skin, and GI tract. On the other hand, if E. coli present in the small intestine, it is harmless. But if it enters inside the urogenital tract or wound, it becomes pathogenic. Now let's check the second stage of disease progression, that is colonization. In order to infect a host, after entry, they have to survive inside our body. Nearly all inner surfaces of our body are protected by epithelial cells and mucous membrane. Some flushing movements can remove invading bacteria and dust particles very effectively. Not only that, most of the areas are already occupied by symbiotic microbes. Competition started due to limited number of binding sites present on the cell surface. After antibiotic treatment, some sensitive symbiotic microbes are killed. After that, pathogenic microbes gain access to the gut without competition. That's why your doctor recommends you to take probiotics in order to restore helpful microbes back in the gut. Most pathogenic bacteria possesses adhesin on the cell surface for the attachment onto the host cell surface that prevent them from being washed out. Flagella and pili in some bacteria helps to specifically bind onto the host cell surface. Neisseria gonorrhoeae use specific outer membrane protein for the attachment, so they are not washed out with urine. Staphylococcus mutants are slimy exopolysaccharide for the formation of dental plaque. Some pathogens cause disease while remaining on the mucosal surface, but many others breach the anatomic barriers. They cross the epithelial cell barriers to reach the nutrient-rich tissues like Shigella, Listeria, Salmonella. Our body also contains a very viscous mucus layer onto the mucosal surface, which can trap microbes and clear them out. Vibrio possesses mucinase enzymes, which help to break down mucus to get access to the cell surface. Proteins produced by the bacteria called invasins, which induce phagocytosis in some cells which are actually not phagocytic in nature. Some bacteria synthesize diverse group of enzymes that break the cementing materials which actually holds the cells together. Flagellated bacteria can move from one place to another by means of chemotaxis. Just after the cut onto the skin, blood clotting blocks the passage of most microbial entry. But some microbes produce a streptokinase to free themselves and enter inside the bloodstream. Streptokinase also has medical importance. Finally, ciliostatic proteins inhibit the movement of cilia on the surface of cells of nasopharynx, therefore reducing the chance of clearance from respiratory canal. In order to reproduce, bacteria must be able to acquire nutrients from the host. Bacteria produces many toxins and enzymes that lyse cell, causing various amounts of damage ranging from local tissue damage to cell death. Iron is an essential for bacterial growth. But inside the cell, most iron are in bound state with plasma transferrin, lactoferrin or hemoglobin. Another group of virulence factors that contribute to bacterial growth are called siderophores, which can remove iron from the transferrin and lactoferrin. Some group of microbes directly lyse RBC to release iron. This phenomenon is called hemolysis. Complete to partial hemolysis occurs by different group of microorganism. When bacteria manage to cross the first line of defense, second one is get activated, that is our immune system. The most important are phagocytosis, complement-mediated bacterial lysis and adaptive immunity. Now let's check how our body attacked them and how they responded. Neutrophil and macrophage engulf microbes, and after phagocytosis, phagosome fused with lysosome. The acidic environment of lysosome kills most of the pathogen. Some bacteria escape this step because of capsule or flagella. Some of them can able to stop the fusion between phagosome and lysosome. Some can withstand extreme harsh condition inside the lysosome. Some of them can able to break the phospholipid membrane of phagosome and escape into the cytosol after phagocytosis. Another line of protection is called complement-mediated cell lysis. Series of caspase proteins are get activated sequentially, and finally they form a pore onto the bacterial cell and kill them. But some pathogens can able to degrade complement proteins, and some can able to prevent the initiation of complement pathway. After the initial entry of the pathogen, within 7 days, our third defense mechanism get activated, that is called adaptive immunity. Antibodies secreted from B lymphocyte reacts with the microbes and helps in phagocytosis. B cell actually recognize and target few unique portions of the bacterial cell. Not only that, a second exposure with the same pathogen lead to a higher but quicker response from the memory B cells. Microbes adopt several mechanism and virulence factor to escape this defense also. Some microbes can destroy secretory IgA antibody, while some changes their body composition regularly. When all those problems overcome, the next step is to destroy cell, acquire nutrition and rapid multiplication and escape. The spread of bacteria from the site of infection to other tissue is aided by the production of a large number of extracellular enzymes and toxins. Toxins and enzymes that break down the cells may also play a role in the distribution of the organism. You can check those enzymes and toxins in this table, and how they help microbes for disease progression are also mentioned. In some cases, not the bacteria, but the toxin actually kills the animal within a few minutes. So in a nutshell, if bacteria win, disease progress. But if host win, bacteria are eliminated from the body. But if it is draw, bacteria will remain inside the body for a longer duration. That leads to a chronic or latent infection. Here, bacteria are waiting for the golden opportunity to attack. Despite all modern scientific inventions like early diagnosis, hospitalization, drug treatment, still microbes able to kill millions of people every year. They are co-evolving with us. So that's all for now. If you like this content, press the like button and share this video. Don't forget to subscribe and press the bell icons for more videos. Visit the community section for more. And finally, thanks for watching.